is one I created for this workshop. Because I was thinking about it more than I'd thought about it before. I'm calling it morphogenic. Anybody know what those two words together would mean? Morpho, I don't know what your word for it is, huh?
Morpheus.
Well, Morpheus had, that's part of his name, I guess. Morph means structure or form. Okay, structure or form. The genic part is from Genesis, which means to create. Okay. Where is a child when they first come into the world? Do they have any meanings formed yet? I mean, how many structures do they have in order to make meaning out of the world around them? Okay, are they anxious about that?
No.
What are they? They're more like curious. Yeah, well, that too. But a small child takes uncertainty and ambiguity and starts to what? Explore. They're curious. What is this? Blah, blah, blah. What happens to that curiosity after you become an adult? What does uncertainty do to you after you're an adult? Notice you'll lose control, which generates the vicious circle. And so we pull back. What most people have not had a good chance to experience is that when you return to that place where most of the structures of meaning have collapsed, and you're standing there with every opportunity in front of you, that's not scary. It really isn't. Once you understand that behind your conscious mental model, behind your current way of looking at the world, is a set of possibilities beyond anything that was imaginable within that world. Now, part of me wants to be seduced into quantum physics here, but I refuse to go there, because that will be tangential to what we're doing. But what this is a place of high ambiguity, uncertainty, but what emerges out the other side was not even remotely in your mind until you went there. That makes sense? That should be close to children. Is your curriculum designed to make sure that happens?
Mm-hmm, yeah. But don't you think there is a difference between the state of the children? They're not aware of their awareness. So I also believe that it's Eckhart Tolle who says that the high level of oneness in children is not compared to an adult who is able to grow into his spiritual path of becoming, because it's of a higher level of meta-awareness. The baby is not aware of his oneness, if you know what I mean.
Well, he certainly would have no way to express it. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
Part of how we begin to gain structure is teach them a vocabulary. Mm-hmm. And we teach them the meaning of the words. So how do you know that child is so primitive? Maybe they are primitive in their ability to operate within the conscious structures being dictated by mommy and daddy.
It's a matter of language.
Yeah.
And expression.
But this is why we go back to what you call preconscious, which I'm calling awareness. Okay?
Okay.
But in any case, I want to assure you that while most of us dread that place, once you discover what it is and you walk around in it for a while, it's quite comfortable and it's quite freeing, and it releases you from all the things you think the this's and the oughts and the what have you are part of. So then we hit motivation. The question is, if you were really going to be able to tolerate that level of ambiguity, to live in a world of both and positive and negative, to be able to put your attention where you wanted to put it, is going to take some real practice. And it's amazing how much time, if you wanted to play a good game of golf or be a better bowler, an athlete will spend the time to do it. If you tell them to do this, they wouldn't walk across the street. They'd just say, that can't be done. That's a matter of values. You will do what you value. So you can come and say, I really like that idea. But if you like your your current idea is better, you're not going to adopt a new one. So you identify, in identifying limitations and options as part of the picture and beginning to commit to what? Putting your attention and concentration all in the same place. And ultimately becoming what I think the child is, a divergent, convergent, emergent cognition integration. Long set of words. And that's because we're adults. That's because we have to use words. But a child intuitively knows that. It's hard for us to intuit it because we have to run it through all of our filters in order to understand it. But the pure light behind the prism does know. Inside the prism, it has to structure anything new coming in according to the current way it makes meaning. Otherwise, you can't do anything with it. Now, why is all this important to what you do? If you want to be a better leader, then of course, it does make a difference. But we're going to, our timeline ends when?
5 minutes.
You got a green one out there. You're supposed to change that.
And 10 seconds.
See, when you're the keeper of the time, you can make it any time you want. Nobody else is following me. Now, I admit, this is a lot of heavy stuff, but I also want you to understand it's heavy because of the way we adults have put our world together. We've made it complicated. The child hasn't. But we gradually educate that child into becoming what? Like us. And we think we're doing them a favor. And yet we also know that if you don't do that, they're not going to make a living. So the question becomes, how do you help them maintain their childlikeness while being able to perform inside the big adult world? Okay, so now's the time. Questions, answers, challenges. It's amazing, if they get tired enough, you can ask them any question you want. You don't have to worry, they're not going to ask one. And I don't blame you. I would.
I have a question, because all what you're telling us is form theory that I would like to apply, but is it realistic to live being 100% of your time aware? Being...
No, the goal would not be to be 100% aware all the time, because we live in a world that requires us to be adaptive. The creative self is an adaptive self to the world in which we live. The creative self is the one that's beyond the narrowness of the mental models that we've created. So we can be and do things beyond where we currently are and still do what's required here.
I have the feeling that we have to question ourselves every time, asking us, well, where am I? Am I aware of what's happening now in my relationship with my colleagues, my family, my husband?
And at first, that sounds very complicated, right?
Yeah.
Over time, it becomes as spontaneous, as easy, as natural as anything. But when you're looking at it from the other side of complexity, it doesn't look like you can get there because you've got to run it through all those complex filters. But the interesting thing is, you do all those complex filters without thinking about it, right? Isn't that true?
Yes.
It gets easy once you're there. I don't know, who was the judge? Oliver Wendell Holmes, is that a name that's familiar to people? I think he was an English judge. But anyway, he said, I wouldn't give a fig. You have figs, right?
Yeah.
He said, I wouldn't give a fig for simplicity this side of complexity. But I'd give my life for the simplicity that's on the other side. Mm-hmm. of complexity. I'm trying to talk to that simplicity. It was innate and spontaneous for the infant. Then we ran it through and taught it to build its own prisms and things, filters and mental models, etc. And then it gets so lost in all of that, it forgets. There's a simple thing called awareness where I can meet a deep peace, a deep joy, a deep love that's always there. But by the time I run all that stuff through these complex things here, it becomes very, very complicated. Okay? What he's saying is, if you could get me through all this mess and bring me back to where I can know what I need to know from this, but re-experience what was here, then I will really know what life was intended to be. My bias is, I am so sorry that it takes this level of complexity to get a view of that simplicity. All the simplicity says is, be aware, be appreciative, create, persevere, and that's all it is. It's that simple. And yet, given the world we've created, it's that complex. And we wonder why, in our country, congressmen and senators cannot sit down, supposedly educated in some of our best universities, and hold a conversation, bringing their differences, and be civil in the process. But they're getting worse, not better. And now we go across and we put nations with nations and all the rest of it. But we're also playing a high stakes game out there. It's a high stakes game. If we cannot learn to talk to each other in more productive, appreciative, and creative ways, and we have it within us, if we can't get there, then we're going to continue to say, well, I'm going to use my filter, and if you don't want to use my filter, then just get out of here. Go. I don't need you. And of course, when that's Russia or Britain, who's going to get a big surprise? They haven't even begun to see the surprise yet. Of course, I might add, neither is the common market. There will be implications and fallout that a lot of people are not going to like hunting.
That's your story. I just want to tackle you a little bit. I'm reading from my own book, you know. And I was thinking of that quote of 13th century, a mystic Sufi poet, Jalaluddin Rumi, Mr. Rumi. He says, out beyond the ideas of right and wrong, there is a field. I will meet you there. To me, that field is awareness. Because in right or wrong, we are filtering. That was your question. We are filtering, and you're right, I'm wrong, Luke. Out of the field, there is a place. I will meet you there. And that children doesn't have problems with that. Children, when they were young, my grandchildren, they were saying, don't step in the river. I didn't see a river, but he was there. Their imagination was beyond filters. The sister was a big princess, and he was a king. And for them it was real. How do you behave as an adult consultant? You step in the river? Or do you go beyond that field of right or wrong? And do you meet in the awareness of the other? What do you think of my rumblings? Make that sense, Rumi?
Where? He's talking the simplicity on the other side of the complexity.
Page
You have to look for it. No, you don't have to read my book, you have to live it.